Hi folks, I'm Matt. Welcome to my top 100 board games of all time. We are in the top 90. Let's do this. Lots of new games, even another one from Queen Games. You know, big surprise there. But at number 90, let's start off with a new game here, Master Builder. In Master Builder, you are trying to get all these craftsmen at certain skill levels to complete certain jobs that you also have to bid on so you can get a lot of money so at the end of the game, you can have the most money to win. I picked this game up for clearance at an online sale, and I haven't regretted it since. I played it at BGGCon. I was like, yeah, this is the game for me. I love how it looks, especially the end game, where you have basically a lot of the city built up. Now, I'll be honest, one thing that we added onto the game is that you keep playing until someone doesn't have a building anymore to build. So we do go one or two extra rounds than the game tells you to go, but no one's upset. We're just trying to build the entire city. I haven't had a game yet where everyone's been able to build everything. And of course, that would be unfair, right? If everyone got to build everything that they bid on, you'd probably get more money at the end. But, oh man, as you see that city coming together, it just looks nice. And every time we play the game, people whoop out their phones and take a picture of the end game, or we'll go ahead and finish the last house or whatnot. It's super simple to play, but a lot of fun. Love the game, Master Builder, my number 90. Number 89 is another new game to my list, and it is, of course, from Queen Games, which is why I love it so. It is Templar, The Secret Treasures. And Templar, you're a bunch of monks running through the abbey trying to hide as many treasures as you can. You also have an abbot who scores things. You also have Severus, who doesn't want you to plant any treasure or will not let you score a room. There's a lot of different cards. Everyone has the same type of cards in their hand, but you cannot play a card that has been previously played by another player. So whatever they last played, you wouldn't be able to play that. You had to play something different. And then when everyone else plays another one, you can play that card you wanted to play. This is great. That one mechanism makes this really cool because it forces you to play different cards you wouldn't, or change your strategy on the fly. Like, I was gonna use Lucas to run real quick and put a ring over in that room, but this guy played Severus now. I can't put a room there. Someone played Porticus and locked me out, so now I gotta go the long way around. It's great. It's really great. Now, when I did my review, I said we hadn't found a way to get some big scoring on there. Well, a bunch of the queenies, I bought a few of the queenies online, and we started playing with those. Yeah, now we found a way to score. Because there's so many other things to do to score points now, the abbot does score a few more rooms. We don't score a lot of rooms with the abbot, but we do score more than we did before, and so scores have been higher, which have made it more fun. So far, everyone who's played this loves the game. Just like a queen game, it looks simple enough, and it's enjoyable enough to play with basically anyone. A lot of these queen games can also be family games, in my opinion. But it's just, the board looks nice, the art looks good, the gameplay is incredible, and like I said, you know, this is another one. Whenever it's a new game, I tend to be as conservative as I can on it. So who knows, maybe this one would even go up. But for right now, it's on the list at number 89. Number 88 was added to my collection at the end of last year. It didn't make the list because, as I'd already recorded the videos, this game came in and I hadn't played it yet. Well, since then, an expansion has come out for the game. So, wow, it is Ghost Fighting Treasure Hunters. And Ghost Fighting Treasure Hunters, you're not only busting ghosts, but you're trying to get these jewels either out of a house or, if you have the expansion, into a cellar. And if you can do that before the ghosts get out of hand, then you win the game. Of course, if there are so many ghosts on the board, if you run out of ghosts to put on the board, you lose the game. This is a simple, and I would even say family, definitely family, co-op game that is incredibly fun. I love co-op games. My board game group isn't the biggest fan of co-ops, but I really love co-op games. I think they're a lot of fun. This one's very simple, easy to understand, obviously. I do love the expansion. I don't think I'll play without the expansion anymore. But the game is very simple. You can make it as hard as you want to. You can take these jewels in order out the door, or in the cellar expansion, it just makes everything harder. And another thing I love about this co-op game, when you win, you are winning barely. You know, unless the cards play well, there's one game we won easily on, but that has only happened once. Man, those ghosts can get way out of hand, and you're going, oh no, we can't move any jewels for the next three rounds because we got to bust some ghosts. There's a great balance in this game, and it's just super, super wonderful. That's why I love it so much, and that's why it's number 88 on this list. Number 87 was number 45 last year. It drops, sadly, 42 hard spots to this level, yet it still is a fun game. It is called Black Fleet. And Black Fleet, you are a pirate ship, a merchant, and you are in control of the two Navy ships that are neutral in the game, but any player can control them. So the Navy ships are trying to sink other pirate ships are trying to rob other merchants, and merchants are just trying to make their delivery to get more coin. Either way, you're going to get coin in this game. When you get that coin, you're going to use it to unlock a card, which gives you a little ability in the game, a little cheat, so to speak, in the game. This is so much fun because it uses some of the mechanisms from another game I love called Machikoro, but it's better than Machikoro because in Machikoro, when you flip over super abilities, it really isn't an advantage or that big an advantage to you than someone else. They could save up and maybe unlock the third card in the row and probably do just as good as you when you flipped over the first two cards, because it depends on what strategy you're working on, right? Well, in this game, everyone has to have the same type of strategy. So if someone gets the first card flipped over, man, you're already, if you're trying to save up to get one of those later cards flipped over first, because those will be more powerful, you're killing yourself in this game. You're killing yourself. Everyone, you've got to go with the lowest card first, because that's going to give you that slight advantage to get more money the next time, to unlock the next card, and so on and so forth. I love this game. It's so much fun. It looks beautiful. The coins are metal, which is always good. The pirate theme in it, this gets played a lot because a lot of my gaming group loves it. So all those things combined, why did it drop so much on my list? That's because there is another pirate theme game on my list, and it kind of bumped Black Fleet down a lot because I'd rather play that pirate game than this one. However, though, every time my gaming group goes, can we play Black Fleet? I'm like, yes, we may, because I always enjoy. Number 86 was number 49 last year on my list. This one took another hard drop down at, I think it's 37 spots here, and it is Shakespeare. And Shakespeare, you are running a show. You're trying to get the best actors, the best costumes, the best set design, and you're trying to improve on all three of your acts before the final show, the curtain call, and everyone comes out and performs the play. This is an incredibly, it looks beautiful, and it's so much fun to play. I do not play this without the backstage expansion. I think the backstage expansion adds so much more to this game, but it is truly an incredibly fun game to play. In fact, it booted another game off my list, sadly, Show Manager by Queen Games, which is also a fun one I enjoy, but Shakespeare works a little bit better for me. So I'm here harping it did so well. Why did it drop so low on my list this year? That's because I found out that you can suffer from analysis paralysis pretty bad in this game. And so some of my game group, there's rounds that would just last forever because there's so many choices to make. You're like, I need this costume, but if I get the costume, they're going to get that set piece. I really need that set piece, but if they get that character, they're going to improve their act, and they're going to be much better, and you can just make yourself dizzy with all the choices there, and unfortunately, some people do, and the game just stretches on too long, in my opinion. However, if you don't have that problem, this is a phenomenal game, and I really, really love it, which is why it's number 86 on my list. Number 85 was number 62 on the list last year, so it drops another 23 spots on the list. It is the classic game of Pandemic. As you know, Pandemic is the classic co-op game where you're going around trying to find the cure for the four diseases, five if you're playing with the expansion, before the city gets overrun with disease and the pandemic truly breaks out and kills the entire world. Yeah, great theme, right? Everyone knows Pandemic. I really don't have to talk much about this. I see this one on a lot of people's top 100 lists, so this is one that we share a lot. They have it ranked probably a little bit higher than this. The reason it keeps getting ranked low is A, of course, my gaming group doesn't really enjoy co-op games that much, but at the same time, whenever we play this one, we win. I can't remember the last time we lost, and I play with Contagion in the lab. We also play with State of Emergency. We've made that deck as hard and as awful as we can, and we have just gotten so good at the game. You're saying, well, Matt, you need to get Pandemic Legacy Season 1, you know? Yeah, my buddy bought it. We intend to play it, and we never got around to it because no one else wants to play a co-op game for that many times in a row. And I've had other people offer to bring over some of their Pandemic versions. Yeah, that's good, and yeah, that has some interesting themes, but to be honest, the base theme is the one that I love the best, and just because I can beat it every time doesn't mean it's a bad game. It's still a fun game, but that is the reason why it drops a little bit on the list. But hey, I still love Pandemic, folks. It's a fantastic game. If it wasn't, it wouldn't even be on my top 100. So here it is at number 85. Number 84 was number 71 on my list last year. It drops about 14 spots, mainly because of basically new games getting added to this list. And it is Abandoned Ship. And Abandoned Ship is the wildest theme ever. You are actually trying to get these rats off this ship. And you have a little disc that has three different colors on it. No one else can see it, but those are the three colored mice that you are cheering for to get out of off the ship in time. Now, the other players may share some of the same colors as you, and then some players may not. So you're drafting dice. Everyone's rolling these dice. You're drafting one of them, and whatever color die you pick, that's the mouse that gets to move up or, you know, do whatever action is on the die. Now, the cool thing about this is whoever gets out first, I guess someone on the Titanic smushed them because they're dead. They're out. So first place gets you nothing, but second place gets you a lot, and so does third and fourth. So you want your rat to go to the top and not to be first. And so it's a game where you don't really know you have an idea of maybe two of the colors that the person likes, but which one of these two are they just trying to kill off, and which one do they want to get points with? I love that point of the game because you're thinking, oh, obviously this guy has black because he keeps moving black. No, he just knows red, which is the color he has, is second place right now, and he wants to go ahead and kill off black so red will be in the lead. I love that. And then once a rat, you know, graduates or gets off the ship, you take their die from the pool, and that way they can't be moved anymore, they can't be chosen. It is a fun little starter game to play with anyone. Absolutely love this game, which is why it's on the list at number 84. At number 83, I have another new game. It's Arcadia. In Arcadia, you're basically playing these cards, placing these little Tetris puzzle pieces out there. You're trying to, it's like a puzzle game. You're trying to surround the other pieces to grab the little marker. And eventually, during the game, you're going to be cashing in all your markers to try to get as much coin as you can. Now, how you do that is every time you get to place a piece and grab a marker, you get to take a little tower with that marker's emblem on it, and you get to place it on the board, in the center of the board. And how you'll have to cover up someone else's marker too. So you're always adjusting the market every time you place one of those towers. And the thing is, you only have four flags on your little player shield that you can cash in at any time to get points with, but you have to be careful when's the best time to cash in. Man, I see there are, you know, three red seals on there, so they're worth $3 each. I don't even know if a fourth one's going to come out in time, and what if some other player covers one of those reds, it goes from 3 to 2. I better cash in right now. There's a lot of other things, because on the board, if you cover these tents, you get extra workers, which can really help you surround other buildings. And there's so much variety in the game that you won't play the same game twice. And I love that. I love that about this game. I played it at BGGCon. I have no idea why I waited so long. I waited like 6 months later on to get it. But we bought it and we've been playing it ever since. It's such a phenomenal game. I love it to death, which is why it's number 83 on my list. My number 82 was number 61 last year, so it drops about 21 spots on the list. And that's okay, because it was the gateway game that brought me back into board games, and that is Zombies by Twilight Creations. Zombies is an easy, you know, roll, move, roll, fight, play cards to help you or screw another player. It's very basic. But again, this is the board game that got me back into games. I said, whoa, board games aren't just Monopoly anymore. And so I still have a special place in my heart for it. Yes, it keeps dropping every year on my list. This year, we did not get to play it, or as of this video, we haven't got to play it. I'm sure we're going to play it around Christmas. We usually always do when my original board game group comes back. But Zombies was a game that I used to play every week. Every week. It was the only game I had with all the expansions. And then I started slowly finding more and more new games and finding out better games out there. Now, Zombies will always stay in my collection. I'll always get the next expansion that comes out, and I'll always play it because I do still enjoy the game. However, they didn't bring out any expansions this year, which is probably another reason of why it dropped. But anyway, great game, still on my list at number 82. And finally, number 81. It was number 51 last year, so it drops about 30 spots here, and the game is called Snowtails. And Snowtails, you are racing dog sleds around the Arctic, and you're playing these cards to adjust your speed, adjust your brakes. You also, whichever way, if you play a stronger card on the left or right side, your sled is going to pull that many points to the left or right. And I love this mechanism in here. This is a very unique and very fun racing game because it takes a lot of thought, takes a lot of skill. You got to manage your cards and find out when you want to turn, when you want to get ready to adjust, maybe go around a tree or take a turn. I've seen games where if you can manage it to take a sharp turn around the inside of a corner, you will take the lead. And we've had that in the game. We've had last place go immediately to first because we're all taking the outside, and he got his cards, played his cards right, and he was able to zip around the inside corner and basically steal the lead from us. Fantastic. I love that part of the game. I think the game is a lot of fun. And I do have the sequel. I do enjoy the buildings that give you like level ups. If you're next to it, you can get just a special ability for that round if you land next to it. We didn't play Snowtails 2 this year, even though the board looks a little bit nicer. I like the tiles better. The board, you just put these discs around it to make it look different, and it doesn't look as good as the tiles. Do. You can't combine the big ceramic houses from the second game to the first game either because they take up too much space. But if I had to pick one, it's going to be Snowtails 1. It's just so much fun. So I'm here, bragging about it. Why'd it drop? Well, A, there's just a lot of new games on my list. And B, I mean, there's a lot of other racing games that I like a little bit better. Yet still, I just want to make a point here that Snowtails is a phenomenal game. I'd never turn down a game of this. So much fun, which is why it's number 81 on the list. Hey folks, that's it. We're done for now. But don't worry, come back and I'll give you my top 80 games of all time. See you then.